Hi everyone, welcome back to Information Economics. So today we will start our introduction about the analysis of information asymmetry. And today we will start by introducing you the screening theory. So I'm going to explain the ideas in a few videos. In the first one, I will talk about the basic introduction. And then I will talk about one example to illustrate the idea.With that example, we will start with the analysis with complete information as a benchmark. And then we will tell you about the incentive issue and one important thing called the revelation principle. With this principle, we can analyze and solve the situation with incomplete information to find the so-called second best optimal solution.And then we will do comparisons to get insights. That will be the main message to deliver to you in today's lecture. Some technical thing will be put in the appendix and we will not talk about it in the video. And I put them in the appendix only for you to, as a reference. If you want, if you prefer, if you are interested in, you may take a look about that or discuss with me, when you...want to do that, but we do not require you to go through the proof. Okay, let's start. So we want to introduce you the idea about information asymmetry, and you already had some idea about it when you read your case one, right? There we introduced you something called adverse selection, moral hazardThose are important types of information asymmetry in those examples in supply chain. And of course, information asymmetry may happen in all kinds of environments. So we will discuss that with a lot of different examples in this course. Today, we start our introduction by talking about the so-called principal-agent relationships. So what's this?In our model or in the environments that we talk about, there will be one principal. This is one player called principal. And one or multiple agents. Okay? Agents are also players. So what's the difference between principal and agents? Principal is the one that designs a mechanism or contract. The principal offers a mechanism or contracts to the agent. And then the agent will...choose their actions according to the mechanism or contract. So sometimes we also call them the mechanism designers and followers. The principal is the designer and the agent is the follower. Okay, like in the examples of supply chains, maybe a company is the principal and its employers are agents, employees are agents.Maybe a manufacturer, an upstream manufacturer is a principal, and the downstream retailer is an agent. Okay, actually you have seen a lot of these kinds of examples in the context of supply chain management. Okay, so that's principal and agents. We study principal-agent relationships in particular when there is information asymmetry between the principal and the agent.Just one remark. Sometimes we may have multiple principals competing for a single agent. Okay? For example, if there is a very strong retailer who is willing to only sell products from one manufacturer, then multiple manufacturers may need to compete for the agent's collaboration or delegation. Okay? So this is called the common agency problem.And it is very complicated. So we will not talk about that in this course. Basically, we will only focus on problems with one principal and one agent. And then there are two kinds of asymmetric information. As you know, the information, the hidden thing may be either the information or either actions.If the hidden part is a piece of information, then we say there is an adverse selection problem. If that's actions, then they are moral hazard problems. So just a quick review about the difference between information and actions. Information is something that the agent cannot decide, or the agent cannot choose, cannot alter. But for actions, the agent can make some decisions. Okay? So for example, consider a manufacturer and a retailer. For the retailer, if the retailer can choose its own order quantity or retail price, then that's actions. Okay? That's actions. And as you already know, typically those actions are non-contractable. So in some sense, they are also hidden. The manufacturer can observe those actions, but the manufacturer just cannot control or cannot contract upon those actions. Okay, those are actions. What are information are something that the retailers know, but the retailer cannot decide. Like how popular the product is, how the market like this product. Okay, those kind of market knowledge is typically hidden information possessed by the retailer. The retailer knows how the market likes it. Or the retailer has this knowledge that is better than the manufacturer. Okay? But the retailer just cannot decide how the market likes this product. So that will be the hidden information. Okay, so we have these two kinds of asymmetric information. From the principal's perspective, if it is a adverse selection problem, then there are also two different kinds of adverse selection problems. The first kind of adverse selection problem is called the screening problem. This happens when the agent has some private information. Okay, so like in the manufacturer retailer example, if the manufacturer is the principal, okay, the contract designer, and when the retailer has some private information about the product popularity or how the market likes this product, then we say the manufacturer, the principal, is facing a screening problem because the manufacturer cannot tell the agent's private information. On the other hand, it may be possible that it is the principal that has some private information. In that case, we say it's a signaling problem. For example, again, manufacturer retailer. Sometimes the manufacturer knows more about its product quality, right? The manufacturer really knows the production process, the quality of the raw materials, or the inspection processes. So the manufacturer knows more about product quality than the retailer. But because the principal, the manufacturer, has no way to guarantee to say to the retailer about the quality, so the principal faces a signaling problem about how to convey the quality information to the retailer. Today, we will only discuss the screening problem. For signaling, we will leave the discussion to the second half of this semester. And by the way, you already see some more hazard problems, right? Because in our manufacturer retailer examples, for example, the return contracts, those retailers' actions, as long as they are non-contractable, we say there is some kind of moral hazard problem. Okay? As long as the manufacturer, the principal, cannot control or contract upon the agent's some actions, we say there is a moral hazard problem. And then there is incentive problem about incentive alignment or induce the agents to do something or something. Okay, that's something you are familiar with. Today we will talk about the screening problem. So, why is screening really a problem? Let's consider the following example. Consider a buyer-seller relationship. Suppose there is a manufacturer who wants to buy a critical component of its product. So this particular raw material comes from a supplier, which is called the seller. So the manufacturer finds a supplier. The supplier really produces this product. And the manufacturer knows something. First, there are two kinds of technologies that can produce this component. Okay? And the more advanced or modern technology can produce this product with a lower cost. There is an old technology which produces the product with a higher cost and a new technology which produces the product with the lower cost. However, the manufacturer just does not know which kind of technology is owned by the supplier. So, the manufacturer knows that it's either the new one or the old one, but the manufacturer does not know which one. Now the question is, how much should the manufacturer pay for each product, for each component? So the problem is basically like this. As a manufacturer, he always prefers the price to be as low as possible. If the manufacturer knows that the cost is low, or the supplier is using the new technology, then of course the manufacturer will try to set the price as low as possible, right? If the cost is $10, the manufacturer may really ask for $12 or $11 as a very low price. However, the supplier will always try to claim that his cost is very high, okay? No matter whether the supplier is using a new technology or an old technology, the supplier will always say, come on, I have so many orders to do, my cost is so high, the materials are so expensive, if you really want this product, I really need to pay a lot to produce them, so you really need to compensate me a lot. The supplier will always claim that the cost is high. In this case, this is exactly something about adverse selection, right? The manufacturer does not know the supplier's cost. And because of that, the manufacturer is facing some issue about bargaining power. If the manufacturer really knows the cost, okay, if the manufacturer really knows the production cost, the manufacturer is at a great advantage about bargaining for the price. But the manufacturer does not know. And then the manufacturer will want to find a way to screen the supplier's type. Here, screen basically just means to know the supplier's type. If the manufacturer can know the supplier's type, obviously, the manufacturer is having more bargaining power. And in expectation, we expect the manufacturer to earn more money. So, as we mentioned, an agent will always try to hide his type. Here, the type is just that piece of information that is private and privately owned by the agent. Typically, that type must appear somewhere in the agent's utility function. So, the agent cares about that piece of information, but that is hidden to the manufacturer, to the principal. Okay, so in the previous example, the manufacturer is the principal, the supplier is the agent, and the unit production cost is the agent's type. To give you more example, for example, one guy is selling the product to many consumers, and the seller does not know how to charge each consumer because the consumer's willingness to pay is hidden. The seller knows that the best way to do is to charge each consumer exactly how much he is willing to pay. But that's impossible because the type, willingness to pay, is hidden. Or, as an advisor, I would like to assign some papers for my students to read, right? But unfortunately, my students' reading ability is somewhat hidden. So I cannot assign them 3 papers or 5 papers to read in each week because they are unable to do that. However, that's actually my belief because my students will always tell me that they are unable to do that. 5 papers are too much. To read each paper, it will take them 2 weeks for doing that. They just cannot afford 5 papers a week. Probably, my students are actually so smart and so excellent. Probably my student can read 5 papers in one day. But they will never told me that. They will always tell me that to read one paper, they need two weeks or whatever. Okay? So, because my students' reading ability is hidden to me, I am facing the question of, I don't know how much is the best to assign to my students. Okay? So that's another screening problem. So very easily, you may find a lot more examples about hidden information or specifically screening. And I hope that you will try to spend some time to think about more examples by yourself and think about whether that piece of private information really help the agent to some extent. So, suppose the suppose the principal knows that there is a private information problem. Okay? So, how may the manufacturer deal with that? Obviously, the first thing to think about is to become more knowledgeable or for the principal to get more information. Okay? I may, for example, as an advisor, hold an exam for my students to show their reading ability. And if their English ability is just too poor, I may, for example, kick them away from my lab. Okay, suppose I really do that, I may get some more knowledge about their reading ability. And that is something we call information-based approach, right? Probably the best way to deal with private information is to learn to obtain those private information. That's going to solve the problem completely. Of course, sometimes that approach is not possible, right? So if that approach is not possible, I am going to try to find some other ways. And that's going to be so-called mechanism design approach, or in the business world, contract design. What does that mean? I know there is a piece of primary information, so when I design a mechanism or design a contract, I would try to design that so that I can find my agent's type. Okay? I will design a contract or a mechanism to offer to my agents. And then I will observe what my agent do, what my agent respond according to my contract. And then I try to find their actions, find their types according to their actions. So today I will tell you how to do that and what's the outcome of doing that. We will start from the easiest case. Now, that will be the model we study in this video. Is that the agent's type has only 2 possible outcomes. Therefore, we call this a two-type model, or we say there are 2 types of agents. If the agents are the supplier we just mentioned, then the cost may be low or high. That's two type. For my student, their English reading ability may be good or bad. That's two type. We're going to assume that the agent's type has only 2 possible values in today's video, and within that framework, we will try to analyze it. Our results can of course be modified so that when the agent has more than 2 different types, we can still handle it, but today we only talk about 2 types. Thank you. Okay, so let's start our analysis. So we will use a so-called monopoly pricing problem to illustrate the idea of information asymmetry or the two-type model. So what's the problem? Suppose that you are producing and sell one product in a particular region and you are the only one who are able to sell this product in that region. Okay, and then your problem is how to price your product to maximize your profit. Of course, there may be multiple factors that affect the answer here, but let's consider the simplest case first. The case is that you know there is a demand function, okay? And that demand function is simply 1 minus p. So that's going to give you a problem to solve like this. You have a demand that depends on your price, and you have a price about that. You may have a production cost, but let's assume there is nothing, no cost there. So your problem is just like this, and immediately you can solve for the optimal price 1/2 and the related profit 1/4. So that's nothing special. But here, please observe the following thing. The demand function 1 minus p actually comes from two assumptions. First, we assume that a consumer's utility for buying that product is v minus p, and v is the consumer's valuation about that product. So what does that mean? Each consumer has a valuation about the product. Some may think the product deserves $1. Some may think the product deserves only $0.7. Okay? So that's the consumer's valuation. As long as the consumer's valuation is greater than the price, the consumer is going to buy it. So that's the basic assumption. And of course, we also make some assumptions about consumer's valuation distribution. Here we assume it is uniformly distributed within 0 and 1. So that means with equal probability, we see a realization within 0 and 1. So that's how we get the profit function, right? Suppose this is P. Given each price P, according to this particular setting, we know the probability for the consumer to buy it is just 1 minus p, 1 minus p, okay? And that goes to our demand function. So our demand function is somewhere like this. Okay, this is 1, this is 1. This is my demand function, q of p. So where is the monopolist profit here? The monopolist sets the profit to sets the price to here, okay, 1/2, and correspondingly we have the quantity 1/2, okay, and the product or the area of this rectangle is just the seller's profit, okay, this is 1/4. If you happen to know something called the consumer's surplus from your economics course, then you know the consumer's surplus are here. The area of this triangle. So why is that? Here, these are the consumers who buy this product. These consumers, their valuation is higher than the price 1/2. So for those consumers whose valuation is within 1/2 and 1, they will buy the product. For each of them, the amount they get is V minus P. Okay? So the total gain or the total surplus earned by the consumers can be calculated like this. Okay, for each consumer, the valuation is V. For V between 1/2 and 1, they earn V minus P. Okay, and after you do this calculation, immediately you can see it's just 1/8. Okay, so it's just the area here. So this is the very basic analysis. So there is really nothing special here. But then, after several days for you to run the business, there comes one guy. This guy tells you that some people are willing to pay more. They are willing to pay more than one half, right? But your price is too low. And also, some potential sales are lost. Some people are not willing to pay one half, but you are charging them too high. So, he gave you a useless suggestion. You actually can ask all those consumers about how much they want to pay for this product, and then charge them different prices. So, he is suggesting you to charge multiple prices for different consumers. Immediately, you know that's impossible. Okay, in this case, that's impossible. We want to do price discrimination. This term basically means to charge different people different prices. However, when consumers' valuations are completely hidden to you, price discrimination is impossible. Okay? Because if you ask each consumer how much he is willing to pay, how do you like this product? No one is going to tell you that I want to pay $0.8. Your product is very good. I just like it. Please, no matter how high the product is, how high the price is, I am going to buy it. No one will say that. Everybody will say your product is ugly, your product is bad, your product is useless. I only want to pay $0.1 to buy it, something like that. So, it is impossible for you to apply this strategy. And that's why information asymmetry creates some difficulty to you. If you can really see those valuations, you will be able to implement this strategy, and then you can earn a lot of money by doing the so-called perfect price discrimination, right? So, to visualize it, suppose you really do perfect price discrimination. Let's see what's going to happen. Again, this is the graph, and this is your price. Your demand function is here. Suppose you do perfect price discrimination, that means here comes a consumer who is willing to pay $0.9. Then you will charge it $0.9 and he will buy the product. So you're going to earn this amount from the consumer. For those guys who are willing to pay 0.8, you will charge them 0.8, and so on and so on. So, you will be able to sell the product to all the consumers at the price, at the highest price that they are willing to pay. So, in total, you are going to earn 1 over 2. Okay? 1 over 2. This is greater than 1 over 4. Which is the original profit that you may do without price discrimination. Previously, you only set one price and earn 1 over 4. Here, you are going to set multiple prices and earn 1 over 2. Okay, that's excellent. So, immediately you can see, if you can see the consumer's types, you can earn more. If you are a principal and you can see the agent's type, you can earn more. That's typically the case. Okay, so information asymmetry. The presence of information asymmetry will create some inefficiencies. In this case, because there is information asymmetry, you only set the price to be one half, and therefore only one half of the consumers earn a non-negative utility. Only one half of the consumers buy this product. Only with probability one half, the trading can really happen. So that's inefficiency. However, information asymmetry is also going to protect the agent, right? Previously, the agent earned 1 over 8 as the consumer's surplus. Okay, consumer surplus. All the consumers together earn 1 over 8 as their utility. But now, they are only to get zero. They are only to get zero because no one is earning a positive utility. So, this also confirms our intuition. Getting some private information helps the agent. Okay? Helps the agent. Here, I want to highlight one thing. We used a few sections to tell you that decentralization will create inefficiency. That's of course true. But decentralization may not be the only reason. Here, in the two situations, either with complete information or with information asymmetry, the system is decentralized. Okay? In the two decentralized system, one is more efficient than the other. The one with complete information is more efficient than the one with information asymmetry. So, for the same decentralization system, information asymmetry may be the reason or may be the source of inefficiency. Okay? So, information is really an issue to consider in any decentralization system. So, in general, no consumer is going to tell you his preferences. So, let's consider the easiest case with valuation heterogeneity. And that's, there are two kinds of consumers. So below, I'm going to formulate the problem with two kinds of consumers. Let's do the following. Suppose consumers now want to buy the product. Okay? If the consumer buys Q units, okay, then the positive utility term is theta times V of Q. Here, V of Q is a function that is strictly increasing and concave. So increasing and concave is just something like this. Okay? Increasing and concave. So this basically means when your Q becomes higher, you're going to become happier. But the marginal utility will decrease. So this is very intuitive, right? If I buy one bottle of Coke, I'm happy. Two bottles of Coke, I can still happy. I'm really happier, but the marginal benefit decreases. There is a type called theta. And theta, we say there may be two values, theta low and theta high, or theta L and theta H. Theta L is a smaller number. So that means if you have a higher type or a higher theta, then you prefer more products or you are willing to pay more for those products. Here, the payment is denoted with the variable capital T. Okay, so that means I, as a consumer, pay T dollars to get Q units. Okay? That's the setting for consumers. Theta H and theta L are possible values of the consumer's type theta. And then we will say that a consumer is of a high type or type H if his type theta is theta H. Otherwise, it's low type or type L. Let's assume that the seller believes there is a probability beta for consumers to have a low type. So beta is of course something that is decided by the seller. The seller does not know how many consumers have a low type, but the seller can do some market research to do some estimations or so on and so on. And the seller somehow will have a belief about that probability. That's going to be denoted by beta. And we're going to assume that that's something constant. Finally, there is a unit production cost, C. So to produce each product, the manufacturer needs to pay C dollars. C is going to be assumed to be somewhat small so that it's reasonable to do business. So, the seller has its utility function, which is T minus CQ. If I produce 10 units, I need to pay 10 times C as my cost. But I can collect some money from the buyers. So, I'm going to have a profit like this. Okay? So, Now, the problem is actually precise. As a seller, I want to price my products so that I can maximize my expected profit. Okay? I want to set price to my products. And consumers may buy multiple products, right? So I am allowed to set different prices for different units, for different number of units. For example, no one says I need to set a linear contract. I probably can do the following. For the first quantity, for the first unit, you need to pay $10. If you buy two, it's $20. But if you buy three, it's going to be $28. Okay? I am just saying that this is allowed because you are allowed to offer discount. Or if the product is very limited, you are allowed to charge more for additional units. So you are facing a pricing problem about how to price different quantities so that you can maximize your expected profit. So how may we do that? Suppose I have complete information. Then when a consumer comes into my store, I see it's type H or type L. Suppose this guy is type H. Then I know what? I know I should solve this problem. I should try to sell him a certain quantity QH and charge him a certain price TH. Here. URS means unrestricted inside, so that basically means TH can be positive or negative, but that doesn't matter. So when I choose these two numbers, there are something that I should know. First, when I say, okay, for these five units, please pay me $50, I need to make sure that that offer is good to the buyer. The buyer should be willing to buy this amount of product because he can get a non-negative utility. Okay, so if I plug in QH and TH into the buyer's utility function, that should be non-negative. Given that, I know for my offer, the agent, the consumer is going to accept my offer. And then I can earn TH minus CQH. So if I see a high type consumer, I do this. If I see a low type consumer, theta H is going to become theta L. And I'm going to solve a different problem. Okay? Because I can see his type, so I can do that. According to different types of consumers, I'm going to solve different problems and make different offers. This problem can be easily solved. The first observation is that no matter what's your solution should have the constraint binding at your optimal solution. Binding basically means a constraint is binding at a solution means that constraint becomes an equality constraint. Okay? So that means if a solution is an optimal solution, it must make that constraint becomes equality. So why is that? Suppose you have an optimal solution which makes theta h times v of q minus t greater than zero. Okay, suppose you have a solution making your constraint strictly positive than zero. Then one thing you may do is to increase T a little bit. That's not going to violate the constraint, but that's going to increase your objective function a little bit, right? So your previous solution cannot be optimal. If a solution is optimal, it must make this exactly equal to zero. So if we have that in mind, we can actually replace TH by this guy, okay? So we are actually solving this problem, maximize theta h vqh minus cqh. And then we have that first order condition, because this is just, basically we can treat this as an unconstrained problem. First order condition is going to tell us that The optimal quantity, let's call it Q tilt H, should be satisfying this equality. Okay? Differentiate this with respect to QH and set it to zero. That's my first order condition. With that, and then my optimal transfer can be decided with this equality. And that's how I may solve this problem. So this solution is not in a closed form because I don't really assign a function form for V. But I know, given any function V, I can do this. So for type I know my solution is like this, right? No matter it is L or U. For different type, theta I has different value. So my solution will change a little bit, but I know how to do that. This will be called the first best solution. First best means the best thing you may want to do when you have complete information. Okay, that's first best. Basically, that's the best you may have when you have complete information. So that's an optimal solution which should satisfy something like this. And then we can see that the consumer is going to earn no surplus or no rent. We like to call them rent in this kind of situation. So what does that mean? For each consumer, he is going to get some quantity Q tilt I by paying T tilt I. And he will realize that by paying that amount to get that amount of units, his utility will be zero. He will be willing to do that, but he is earning nothing. Okay, he is really earning nothing. And that means the seller extracts all the rents from the consumer. Okay, so with complete information, we know how to solve that problem, and we can see the seller is really happy because the seller earns everything from the consumer. Just like the very simple example with all the triangular part goes to the manufacturer, right? So later we will tell you what's going to happen when there is information asymmetry, how to solve that problem and try to deliver some insights to you. Thank you. So we have completed our derivations about complete information. Now let's talk about information asymmetry and see what's going to happen when the agent's type is not observable by the manufacturer, by the principal. So when the valuation is hidden, we know the first best plan does not work. Okay? Because I cannot decide my offer by observing the agent's type. Also, I cannot offer a menu of the two offers for the consumer to select. So what does that mean? I know the consumer may be of low type or of high type. I know when he was a low type, and if I can see it, I offer this to extract all the surplus from him. Or if he was a high type and I can see it, I offer this. So this is a collection of my first best offers. And I put it as a menu. That means, okay, now comes the consumer. I cannot see its type. And then I offer these two contracts to him for him to select. Okay? So for example, this may be 5 units, $100. And 8 units. $200, something like that. I give him two pairs of two contracts to select, and he may choose either this one or that one. We hope that the low type consumer will choose this one and the high type consumer will choose this one. If that's true, I can still get everything I may get, okay? And information asymmetry is nothing. But that's not going to happen because both types will find the low type contract is better. Why? Suppose you are a high type consumer. You see these two offers. You're going to evaluate which offer gives you a higher utility. Okay. And of course, you see, the high type offer gives you nothing. Your utility will be zero. But the low type is different. You will evaluate your utility function. Your type is data H. So this is your willingness to pay. And you get a quantity by paying something. Okay? You also know that T tilt L satisfies T tilt L equals data L VQL. That Q tilt L. Okay? This is something you know. You know these two quantities are identical. And then you immediately see that theta H minus theta L is positive. This V function is also positive. So as a type H consumer, you are earning a positive rent or a positive utility by choosing the low type offer. Okay? So this tells us that this is not going to really give us the first best outcome, the first best profit. And it turns out that this particular solution is also not optimal under information asymmetry. So anyway, this strategy will simply fail. We say that this particular offer is incentive incompatible. What does that mean? This happens when one type of consumer pretends to be another type. In this example, if you are high type, you will choose the low contract, okay? And we say the high type guy is pretending to be a low type. Oh. And this fits our common intuition, right? There comes a consumer. You ask him, do you like my product? They will always say, I hate your product. Okay? They will always say, I hate your product. They will say, I prefer the low contract. And that's going to be their actions. So you cannot make the contract, you cannot make these two offers incentive compatible, because consumers will choose the same contract. Okay? So on the opposite side, a menu will be called incentive compatible if different types of consumers will select different contracts. In that case, we say those contracts can induce truth-telling. And after we observe the selection, we can identify the type. Okay, so suppose I do not offer these two contracts. I offer something else. And I know suppose low type guys will choose one kind of contract, and high type guys will choose the other contract. Then according to their action or according to their behavior, I can tell what's their type. Okay? That's something that we may do according to our contract design. So let's see how may we do that. Suppose I offer QLTL and QHTH, and suppose I want it to be incentive compatible. The idea is very simple. I need to make sure that the type H consumer should choose QHTH, and that means by choosing QHTH, his utility should be no less than the utility for choosing QLTL. Okay? Then I can induce, by designing these four numbers carefully, I can induce the high type consumer to choose QHTH. Similarly, for type L consumer, I need to design these four numbers carefully so that I have this condition, I have this inequality. And then the low type guy will find choosing the low contract is better than choosing the high contract. Please keep one thing in mind. No matter what the contract you choose, your type will still be the same. Okay? So at both sides, you see theta L. But for Q and T, that depends on your choice. So this constraint is saying for the low type guy should choose Q QLTL instead of QHTH. These two constraints are called incentive compatible constraints or choose tailing constraints. If your four numbers satisfy these two constraints, your offer will be incentive compatible. And in equilibrium, this consumer is going to tell the truth. Okay, tell the truth. Another set of constraints are individual rationality constraints or participation constraints. They are saying that these consumers should at least get a non-negative utility by choosing the contract that you prefer them to choose. Okay? So as a high-type consumer, I can see by selecting the contract that is intended for me, I can get a non-negative utility. And also, I prefer that to a low-type contract. So I will really choose the high-type contract. Okay? That's something the principal must have in mind. So if I design my offers by satisfying these four constraints, I can really offer an incentive compatible and acceptable menu. But is it optimal? Okay, or is it optimal? No one can answer that at this moment, right? So let's continue. The thing is that inducing truth-telling is really optimal. Also, I don't know how you feel about this. When the first time I see this, I was shocked. Okay? There are so many different kinds of contracts. There are so many possible pricing mechanisms, right? Some may be incentive compatible, some may be not. And you probably can imagine, only a very limited number of contracts are incentive compatible. Most of them are not. But what's interesting is that among all those incentive compatible mechanisms, at least one of them is optimal. This is called revelation principle. So let me say that again. Suppose in the world there are so many different contracts. Okay, so this black circle means all the contracts. Some of them are incentive compatible. Some of them are incentive incompatible. Okay? So incentive compatible contracts are just part of all the contracts. Among all the contracts, some of them are optimal. Optimal means I offer this menu or I offer this mechanism, and then the agents will act by maximizing their own expected utility. And then I can earn the highest amount of profit. Okay? Then I call them optimal mechanisms because they give me the highest amount of revenue or highest amount of profit. This result is saying that this particular area here, okay, is non-empty. I don't need to investigate or search among all possible contracts. I only need to search among incentive compatible contracts. Within this subset, I find an optimal contract. Okay, within this subset, I find the best contract. That's going to be the best among all possible contracts. That's revelation principle. The best thing to do is to reveal the agent's type. The best thing to do is to reveal the agent's type. This revelation principle has been contributed by many great economists, okay, including Mirrlees, Meskin, and Meyerson. And these three scholars, they got Nobel Prize in economic science. Okay, and those works dates back to 1970s. So they established the field of information economics by providing a framework for analyzing the screening problems. Okay, and then to highlight their contributions, they were awarded the Nobel Prize in economic science. So that's some related backgrounds. So you can see that the screening theory or the theory about information economics is really something in the economics, in economics. So once we apply the revelation principle, the idea is now clear. I only need to search among those truth-telling contracts, and that's going to make different types of consumers select different contracts in equilibrium. And that will allow me to know what they will do. That's the second stage problem, right? And then I can formulate my first stage problem to try to maximize my expected profit like this. I should design four numbers or two contracts so that they are incentive compatible and individually rational. Okay, if I have IC and IR constraints, then in equilibrium, high type consumers will choose QHTH, and the low type consumers will choose QLTL. And also, I know with probability beta, I see a low type consumer, and the outcome will be QLTL. So this will be my profit when I see a low-type consumer. If I see a high-type consumer, I earn TH minus CQH as my profit. So this is my expected profit. I design these four numbers to maximize my expected profits. And the best thing is that I know I can impose these constraints to limit my search space. Okay? I am solving this problem to find the best incentive compatible menu, and that's going to be the best menu in the world. Okay, so this is really the seller's problem to solve. So one very significant improvement in this field is of course the revelation principle. If we do not have this principle, we cannot really claim this is the right problem to solve, right? Because solving this problem may not give you an optimal solution. But because we have revelation principle, we know the optimal solution to this mathematical program is just what the seller should offer. Okay, so that's significant. I'm not going to prove this for you, but if you are interested in the idea, I provided the sketch of the idea in the last two slides. In these slides. Okay, so that's something you may want to check. In the next video, we're going to solve this problem. Thank you. Okay, so now let's try to solve the problem we just formulated. And our goal will be to find the second best optimal solution. So to just a review, first best means when you have complete information, the best policy to do. And the second best is under information asymmetry, what's the best pricing plan for you to offer? Okay, so now we will introduce the standard way for solving this standard two-type problem. Sometimes you will see some variants of this problem, but in many cases, the following standard way will be able to solve or at least greatly reduce the complexity of the problem. So please pay attention to the following analysis. The key is that we want to analytically solve the problem. Only with analytical solutions we may generate general insights. Okay, so we're going to do that. Oh, by the way, so just a review. IC constraints, IR constraints, and the objective function. The term analytical solution basically means I want to know in my optimal solution how these four decision variables are the functions of parameters. Here parameters include beta, C, theta H, and theta L. Okay, I want to express my decision variables as the functions of parameters. So the first observation we may get is to add the two IC constraints together. So this is ICH and this is ICL. If we add them together, I'm going to cancel these four T variables, right? And then I will only get this as the sum of these two terms, which will be greater than or equal to the sum of the other two terms. Then we do some arrangements. Let me put the two terms with VQH together. So I'm going to take this term to the left-hand side. I can get something like this. And similarly, I will get something like that in the right-hand side. Because theta H minus theta L is positive, I can remove them. And then I can get something like this. V of QH will be greater than or equal to V of QL. And then, because V is increasing, okay? Because V is an increasing function. So if QH is greater than, if V of QH is greater than V of QL, then I immediately know QH is greater than QL. Okay, so that's some results I may get. This result is called the monotonicity condition. It says that if a plane is incentive compatible, then the high type consumer will consume more, or in the optimal plane, we should offer more consumption to the high type consumer. Okay? Because this condition comes from these two constraints, if a solution is feasible, it must satisfy this condition. So that's something we are talking about. If we want to induce the two players or the two types of agents to tell the truth, then QH must somewhat be greater than QL. Okay? There must be an intuition like this, right? The intuition is simple. High type consumers basically prefer the high consumption because they are willing to, they get more, they get higher utility when they get a higher consumption. So if we want them to prefer the contract intended for them, QH should be greater than or equal to QL. Okay, so that's the first insight we may get. Now, consider the following. I can combine ICH and IRL to imply that one of the constraints IRH is redundant. So, what's that? First, we can see that my ICH constraint says this. Okay, the high type consumer should prefer the high contract to the low contract. And then from here to here, it's simply an application about Q, theta H is greater than theta L. Okay, V is positive, so theta H is greater than theta L. And then the right-hand side, this term is exactly the left-hand side of IRL, because the low-type consumer should get at least zero. Okay, so combining this, we know that IRH must be redundant. If I can satisfy ICH and IRL, I can satisfy IRH. Okay, so that means in my program, IRH is useless and I can take it away. It must be satisfied. The intuition is that the high type consumer will earn a positive rent or a positive utility. And immediately we know, as a manufacturer or as a seller, I now cannot extract everything from the agent. The agent will be able to get at least something. Okay? I haven't really solved this problem, but through my analysis I can know this. So now I have three constraints left. Now I'm going to guess that ICL will be redundant for a while. Okay? So I haven't proved that ICL should be redundant, but now I am guessing that it will be redundant or it will be satisfied. So what does that mean? I think the low-type consumers does not have any incentive to pretend to be a high-type. Okay? If you ask a consumer, and if he really hates your product, there's no reason for him to say your product is good. I'm going to pay you a lot of money. That's impossible. So we have this intuition, and that intuition guides us to assume that ICL should be redundant for a while. I'm going to ignore or relax ICL, and later when I get an optimal solution, I will check whether that constraint is really satisfied. So this strategy is familiar, right? When we have a constraint optimization problem, we may relax some constraints and then try to get an optimal solution. If that optimal solution really satisfies all those relaxed constraints, then we're done. So I'm going to play the same trick here. After that, I only have two constraints left. With these two constraints, I'm going to claim that both constraints must be binding at any optimal solution. So again, binding means that constraint must be equality at this optimal solution. So let's see why. Consider the first constraint. The first constraint has TH there. As a seller, I want TH to be as high as possible. So I will keep increasing TH until I cannot do so, which means until TH is bounded by ICH. Okay, I will keep increasing TH until the constraint is binding. If the constraint is not binding, I definitely can choose to increase TH to earn more. So ICH must be binding. At the same time, IRL must also be binding. So for IRL, I have TL here. I will try to increase TL until the second constraint is binding. You probably want to ask, TL is also here, right? That's a good observation, but here, TL is at the right-hand side of ICH. When I increase TL, that simply relaxes this constraint instead of making it tighter. So when I increase TL, I will never violate ICH. So it doesn't matter. I can keep increasing TL without considering ICH until I hit the boundary of IRL. So I know both of the constraints will be binding. And you probably want to verify this. If we did not ignore ICL, the constraint that we ignored in the previous slides, then we cannot claim that IRL will be binding because TL will also appear here. Then we can only say either this one or that one will be binding. Oh, then things will become more complicated. But with the previous observation, now things go smoothly. So now the problem really becomes this one. One objective function, two equality constraints. When we have an equality constraint, that just means we can remove one variable. Because once I know, for example, QL, I know what's the value of TL, and so on. Okay, so I'm going to replace TL by theta L VQL. And then I'm going to replace TH by this and this. Okay, so that's my idea. So I know in an optimal solution, TL and TH must be blah, 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 expressed in this way. And then after that, I will get an unconstrained problem like this. TL is replaced by this term. And TH is replaced by these three terms. This is my unconstrained problem. In the next video, I will complete the solution process for solving this problem and then discuss the insights. Thank you. Okay, so now we know that our original problem with four constraints can actually be reduced to these unconstrained problems. And this is through our observations and analysis about that problem. We know some properties about that problem, and then we may reduce that problem to a simplified form. But the optimal solution is, of course, still there. Okay, So, to solve this problem, recall that our decision variables are the quantities that we offer to the agent or to the consumer. Okay? We're going to decide how much we want to give to the consumer of high type and how much we want to give to the low type. We will collect some money from them, and that can be decided by the two binding constraints in the previous slides. Okay, so now we have this question with Q as our decision variables. The good news here is that because V is strictly concave, we can show that this two-variable problem can also be shown to be strictly concave in QH and QL. Okay? In particular, QH and QL are somewhat unrelated. Okay? Unrelated. So all you need to do is to differentiate this objective function with respect to QH and QL. You are going to get two equations, and that's going to help you to derive the first order condition like this. Okay? As long as the parameter is not very weird, then your second best solution, your second best menu can be derived or can be expressed in this way. So for QH, this of course comes from your derivative with respect to QH. When you do that derivative, you may see that only this part matters. Okay, only this part contain QH. So your QH comes from there. Shouldn't be too hard. And for QL, you get something from here and here. So you probably want to do this exercise by yourself. Differentiate the blue parts with respect to QL to see whether you can get something like this. This condition is for you to have a positive denominator here. If your denominator is negative, then that means your quantity should be negative, which is impossible. Okay, so we have a condition here. If this condition is violated like this, then your QL will be modified to the minimum level, which is zero. That means you find the low type consumer too unprofitable, so you will not really trade with him. Okay, and in any case, you will trade with the high type guy like this. Okay, so that's our solution. So now all we have our last step is to verify the previously relaxed constraint ICL is satisfied. To see this, note that as an optimal solution, we have these two equalities, right? So ICL, this guy, can be replaced by these two equalities. And after some arithmetics, we can show that it will be something like this. And then this is positive, this is positive, this is negative. So ICL can be satisfied with any optimal solution. So with that, we complete our analysis about this problem. We can really show that how to get an optimal or second best menu according to our parameters. Okay, that's the end of the solution. Now we want to talk about some findings with the solutions. The first thing is to compare our second best solution with the first best solution. And here, we use tilt to denote the first best solution. Okay? When we compare the consumption level or the quantity with the first best quantities, immediately we can see that for the high type consumer, the two conditions are the same. So the high type consumer will still get the first best amount. So that means at the high type part, this solution is the same. Okay? But for the low type part, we can show that this is the condition with complete information, and this is the condition with information asymmetry. because this particular term is less than 1. This particular thing is greater than C. Okay? And then that means you have this relationship. Your V prime Q tilde L should be less than your V prime Q star L. And because V is increasing and concave, that means V prime is decreasing. Okay, the slope of this function is decreasing. And what does that mean? Let's look at this figure. Suppose you have a decreasing function, and you know your, let's say, call it F. If your F of A is less than F of B, then that means A is greater than B. Okay? So, if V prime Q tilde L is less than V prime Q star L, then that means Q tilde L is greater than Q star L. Okay, just like this. So, the high type consumer will still get the first best amount, but the low type consumer will only get something that is less than the first best amount. Okay? So that means our second best solution and the first best solution are different. Okay, so the first thing is to see is different. And different doesn't definitely means inefficiency, because complete information is the best outcome, the best possible outcome. And with information asymmetry, our outcome is different. In particular, the consumption level is lower. Okay? So the whole system is creating fewer utility to everybody. The system is inefficient. And that, of course, is because the seller does not observe the consumer's type. Okay? This inefficiency comes from information asymmetry. Then you will have one question. There is a deviation from the first best solution. The second and the low type consumption level is smaller. Is it possible to become bigger? According to our analysis, it's impossible. You will only decrease the consumption level for the low type consumer. You will never make it larger. And also, you will not try to alter your high-type consumer's consumption. Why? Let's answer it. So regarding the consumption level, the most important observation is that we decrease QL. Why the seller want to decrease QL? Remind yourself that the seller is trying to maximize its own profit. So the seller do so, if the seller does so, it must be because it is beneficial. So think about this. Suppose the seller offers the first best menu, then the high type consumer will pretend to be a low type, and the positive payment that the high type consumer can get is derived like this, right? So this tells us that if we want to extract surplus from the high type consumer, I should decrease QL. As long as I cut down QL, I am going to limit his incentive about lying. Okay, when I decrease QL, the high type consumer will find it less profitable to pretend to be a low type. So that's the main reason to decrease QL, even though it creates some inefficiency, even though it disallows us to earn as much as in the past from the low type, that's going to help us get profit from the high type. Okay? So the main reason to decrease the low type consumption level is because of this, because I want to cut down the rent obtained by the high-type consumer. Then we have some other observations. In equilibrium, the low-type consumer earns nothing, okay? Because IRL is binding. However, we have shown to you that the high-type consumer still earns a positive amount, This and this looks very similar, right? But because Q star L is less than Q tilde L, you know, we have successfully lowered the high-type consumer's rent, or in this case, we call it information rent. The high-type consumer can earn a positive utility because of what?It's not because he is more diligent, or it's not because he has more power, or it's not because he is smarter. It's simply because it has some information. Okay? When he does not have that piece of private information, no matter it's low type or high type, it gets nothing. But now, because the agent has the private information, the agent can enjoy a positive utility in expectationAnd that is called information rent. Okay, so we have two observations now. At the low type, the quantity becomes smaller, and the low type consumer gets nothing, but the high type consumer can still get something. Okay, so finally, note that the high type consumer's rent depends on Q star L. Okay, so.All we want to do is to cut down the information rent obtained by consumers. You are the principal. He is the agent. The best way for you to optimize your profit is to try to limit the agent's profit. If you want to do that, you will try to cut down his information rent, because that private informationgives the agent some rent, and you want to limit the amount of rent, then you will be able to maximize your profit. Okay, so now we have introduced the idea of information asymmetry, and how may we formally formulate it as a mathematical problem. We are able to solve the complete information problem, and we are able to solve the second best or the information asymmetry problem. We have the first best and the second best mechanisms, and we see that we have the following observations or insights. For the second best solution, basically we have three things. First is monotonicity. The high type consumer will be offered more than the low type.And this is because the high-type consumers prefers a higher consumption. Because they prefer that, so you give them that. That's going to make you easier to earn more money from them. Okay? Monotonicity. And then is something we call efficiency at top. The high-type consumption level is efficient. And that basically means...Q star H is equal to Q tilde H. Now, this is the so-called efficiency at top. The high-type consumption level is efficient. Finally, there is no rent at bottom. The low-type consumer earns no rent, while the high-type consumer can still earn some rent. Okay? Finally, don't forget that there is a downward distortion from the low type. So, for the low type, the second best consumption level is less than the first best consumption level. This is a downward distortion from the original efficient level to a smaller level. Okay? So, information asymmetry creates...these situations create the downward distortion. But keep one thing in mind, information asymmetry helps the agent or protects the agent. If there is no information asymmetry, then the agent is going to earn nothing. Okay? So the information asymmetry is going to earn nothing. With information asymmetry, the agent earns something, so the agent is happy because he has that piece of information and he will try to always hide that piece of information for the agent to earn something. So sometimes this is good, but sometimes it is bad from the society's perspective. For example, if the principal is an employer and the agent are some employees,We hope that the employees can still get some positive utilities in general, right? So in that case, we prefer to have this information asymmetry. But if we consumers are principal and sellers are agent, then, for example, if product quality or the raw material source are their private information, then it's bad to the society. So whether information asymmetry is really good or not really depends on what's the problem we are talking about. But if we are talking about efficiency, then generally it's bad. If we are talking about the principle, principle never prefers the agent to have some private information. Okay, so that's our first introduction about private information. We will give you more examples and using different perspectives to talk about this problem and how information and information asymmetry may affect the interactions of all players in a decentralized system. That's the end of today's videos. Thank you.